Hey, welcome everybody to Albuquerque's First Baptist Church. I hope that you're having a fantastic morning, and thank you for coming to worship with us. Hey, just a couple quick announcements. We're still receiving diapers and wipes for Alongside Ministries, and if you got a tag to get gifts for them, please try to bring those back in November. You guys have been so generous, so thank you so much for all of your help with this. It's going to be such a blessing for these moms and their babies. The children, just amazing, amazing, amazing. So thank you for that. I hope you have a great Thanksgiving and just be thankful to God for everything that's going on. The final thing, we're going to have a business meeting second Sunday in December, and you should be getting something probably next week in the mail or email about the details for that. So please just be praying that we'll be about God's business, and I look forward to seeing you there. We're going to try to set up a Zoom link, so if you can't make it in person, we'll do virtual business meeting, and it's going to be amazing. So can't wait to see you there. Hey, let's pray. Then Pastor Jerome's going to lead us in worship, or Rebecca's going to lead us in worship, not Jerome. He's going to be helping another church this weekend, and then we're going to get into God's Word. So pray with me. God, thank you so much for Jesus Christ. Thank you for the fellowship that we share in Him. God, thank you for the way you always provide for us, Lord, as we work through your word today, just look in the Psalms. I pray that you would show us that we can take refuge in there, in you. And God, we just thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So good. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after me. Your goodness is running after me. With my life laid down and surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me. All my life you have been faithful. Of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. The love of God goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. Could we and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, would drain the ocean. Stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels.
Hey, good morning. Here we are in Psalm chapter 11 today, and this time it's right. If you were here last week, you can go back and it said 11 also, but this time it really is. And we're going to take refuge in the Lord. And today, just a great psalm. It's just such a praise psalm to God, and it talks about the way we can take refuge in God because of who He is. Today it's really great because we're going to do Lord's Supper too. So if you're joining us online at home, grab some grape juice or something to drink. Some bread, something to represent the body of Christ. Really, let me just say, we do this as a symbol and a remembrance, a memorial. It really doesn't matter what you use as much as the heart intent that you have behind it. We use the unleavened bread because Christ was without sin. We use the juice because it represents the wine or the fruit of the vine that represents the blood of Christ, right? And the blood sheds for our sins, covers us. The body was broken for us, and it has great symbolic meaning. But hear me carefully, it does not do anything magical to eat a little wafer of bread or drink a little bit of juice. What matters is the intent of our heart to remember Christ. So today, as we take refuge in Christ, take refuge in the Lord, we're going to remember this. And so kind of big idea for today, what I want you to see is the Lord is a stronghold for the righteous. Therefore, we can stand against the wicked. And so what is true? The Lord is a stronghold for the righteous. And what I want you to understand, Christian, if you're listening today, you are righteous before God because of Jesus Christ the Son. When we talk about the blood, when we talk about the body that was broken, it's that blood that covers me that makes it so I can stand before God justified, just as if I'd never sinned. I am righteous before God the Father. He looks at me. He sees the life that Christ lived because Christ died by the punishment that I deserved. We are absolutely righteous before God. Because we're righteous, the Lord is a stronghold for us. And what that means is that our God, the great God, that's creator of the universe, of heavens and the earth, that we've read about for 10 Psalms, where this God always saves, He's always there, He's always protecting, always there for His kids. He is absolutely there for you through all of life's troubles. And so what it means is we can stand against the wicked. And that's important because when the Psalm plays out, as it plays out, what we'll see is that it begins like, hey, God is there for us. And then it takes a break, and it's like there's this antagonist inserted into the text. And the antagonist, he's trying to attack the believer, right? And he's like, oh, the Lord's your refuge? Well, how could you stand if the bad guys are coming after you? And what we need to understand is that we can stand against the wicked. Why? Because the Lord is a stronghold for the righteous, and we're righteous. We know that because of the blood of Jesus Christ, right? So here's the text. It's going to begin, in the Lord I take refuge. How can you say, so here's the antagonist, how can you say to my soul, flee like a bird to your mountain? For behold, the wicked bend the bow. They have fitted their arrow to the string to shoot in the dark at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? And so the antagonist is they're trying to knock us off, knock us down, push us, keep us from being effective ministers or servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. But in the Lord we take refuge continues. Right, the Lord is in His holy temple. It's the response to the antagonist. The Lord is in His holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes see, His eyelids test the children of man. The Lord tests the righteous, but His soul hates the wicked and the one who loves violence. And let Him, let God, rain coals on the wicked, fire and sulfur, and a scorching wind shall be the portion of their cup. For the Lord is righteous. He loves righteous deeds. The upright shall behold His face. And so again, just the big idea that I want you to see, the Lord is a stronghold for the righteous, right? God is absolutely there for you. He's 100% there for you because you're washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. You're righteous before God, right? And if you're not, just time out. If you're not righteous before God, today can be the day of salvation. Today can be the day when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior forever because he died for you. You believe that He's the Son of God, that He died for your sins on the cross, that He rose again on the third day, that He's coming back to judge both living and dead. If you would believe that, you would be righteous before God, and then he'll be your stronghold. And if He's your stronghold, then what can you do? You can stand against the wicked. You can stand up to the wicked. You can know with absolute certainty that the wicked is not going to knock you down or destroy you or kill you because God is for you. And if the Lord is for us, who could stand against us? Today, then, what we're going to do is take refuge in the Lord. We'll end with the Lord's Supper. But first, we're going to talk about trusting the Lord. And we're going to look at in the psalm what it talks about to trust in the Lord. There's at least seven reasons in this psalm that we can trust God. And then we're going to talk about the enemy wants us to flee. Right? And so the way it plays out in life is we know, like, I'm going to trust in the Lord. And have you ever been there where you're like, I'm going to trust in God? And then somebody's like, do you really want to do that? Maybe it's a voice in your head, or it's your own insecurities, or it's somebody you thought was your friend. Maybe it's another person in the church or a Christian, and you're like, I am going to go and tell everybody about Jesus. And they're like, sit down. You don't need to go do that. And they're just, they're trying to pour water on your fire. The enemy wants us to flee. The devil wants us to flee. The bad guy wants us to flee. And God tests the Christian. So the fleeing often leads to suffering. And there's two kinds of suffering. It's number 3 and 4. God tests the Christian. We suffer sometimes. We're going to talk about suffering of Christians and the testing suffering of Christians. And then we're going to talk about the suffering of the wicked. And this is, I like the way the psalmist says it, God rains down coals like fire on the wicked. And I'm like, yes, go Jesus, because he's whooping up on the wicked guy. And if we're righteous in Christ before God and we see righteous judgment, it should make us happy. So here we go. First, trust in the Lord. In the Lord, I take refuge. And so it shows a couple of things. So first, it's exclusivity. We are exclusively only taking refuge in the Lord God. So that matters. What it means is that it is not in my, I don't know, my case of beer that I'm taking refuge. It's not in my 401k that I'm taking refuge. It's not in my friends. But at the end of the day, if all of that were to go away, my refuge is the Lord God Almighty. It is exclusive in Christ or in God and only in God or maximally in God. Doesn't mean you shouldn't have friends or people to help you or whatever, even a hobby. But ultimately, at the end of the day, more than anything else, God is our refuge. The second thing I want you to know is that as we take refuge in God, it's not just God more than anything else, but it is God because he is able to be our refuge. Right? And so I've got, like, in the psalm, there's seven reasons we can trust in the Lord. First, and these are, what I did is I just looked at the text and I pull it out in verse 11 or chapter 11, and I just go through the text and I look at all the reasons why this psalmist is saying he can trust in God. And I want you to notice in the text, the way it plays out is there's this guy and he's like, I'm going to trust you always, God. And then the antagonist comes in and says, oh, are you sure you want to do that? And then he's reminding himself over and over, well, this is why I trust God, and this is why I trust God, and this is why, and this is why, and this is why, and this, and so why? Because the Lord is in his holy temple. God can't be touched. Maybe there's a wicked guy, a bad guy, maybe there's the devil. The devil is not equal to God. He's not the other half. It's not like yin and yang. It's just, there's just God, and everything else is below God, and God is in his holy temple, and nobody is going to hurt God. God's throne is in heaven. No, again, it's so removed from anything on earth, any of our problems. Third, his eyes see. Like, God sees what's going on. He's not blind. He's not busy. He looks. He's not, you can't hide from him. The wicked guy around the corner in the shadows, wherever he might be, he's not hiding. God knows. He knows what's going on. And so we trust the Lord because his eye sees. His soul hates the wicked. So we trust God. Do you know what this does for us? As we look out in the world and we see the wicked, we see the evil, we see the person oppressing the poor or the downcast, and they're just like beaten up on them, whatever. Like, God hates that. And I know it may be strong words, but this is what the psalmist says. God hates the wicked. The Lord is righteous. So when we, as righteous in Christ before God, go out into the world, we know that the Lord is righteous and he loves righteous deeds. And so we look and we say, man, God, I can trust you. I can trust you because, God, Jesus Christ has redeemed me, and you love the righteous, and I'm doing my best to do righteous deeds before you. Like, just, hey, you know, even at church, as we're receiving diapers and wipes for Alongside Ministries, it's righteous deeds, and God loves righteous deeds. Or when we see in church planters, or when we work with our kids, or when we just, any ministry we do for God, it's righteous deeds that we're doing. And then number 7, the upright shall behold his face. And so at the end of the psalm, the psalmist is just looking and saying, man, God, I begin and you're my refuge, and at the end, I know with absolute certainty that those who are righteous are going to see you face to face. And so all of these seven reasons we trust the Lord. Now, important, right? Because we start off trusting the Lord, and quickly, as soon as we trust the Lord, what happens? The enemy wants us to flee. Do you see what the text says? How can you say to my soul, and then in quotes in your Bible, most translations will put quotes in there. It's obviously offset in the text. It's like, God, I trust you. And why, enemy, are you going to say to my soul, flee like a bird to your mountain? Do you see what the intention is? It's poetic, like, oh, little sparrow, just run along. There's no way you can stand before the wicked. Just go. Just go. Don't do that. For behold, the wicked bend the bow. They fitted their arrow to the string to shoot in the dark at the upright in heart. And so what's he saying? Like, hey, you, Christian, just get out of here. Fly away like a sparrow because we're in the dark. You're not going to see us, and we're pulling back our bow, and we're going to absolutely destroy you. If you do this thing you think God wants you to do, you're going to fail. You ever hear that voice? The person who says, you're not good enough, you're not strong enough, you're not fast enough, you don't know enough, that you're not Christian enough, you're not righteous enough, you're not just fill in the blank enough to be used by God. Do you know what they're doing? They're trying to destroy the foundations of the righteous. And what the enemy, the antagonist says is, what can the righteous do? And so all of this, what's going on is he starts off, I'm trusting the Lord. And as he continues, the wicked person is there trying to destroy the foundations in your life and in mine to keep us from moving forward for God. And let me, as we talk about this, just mention four kinds of ways that the wicked attack our foundations. First is loss of identity. Pluralism, assault on Christian values, and like the social gospel we see more and more these days. But loss of identity, sometimes we look at the way things were, and it's not that way. And we see the enemy like telling us, church was good 50 years ago, but today it can't be good enough. Right? And what they're doing is they're trying to get us to think that we've lost the battle just because things have changed. Maybe our place has changed or God is transitioning us roles. And listen, it's a good thing. Think COVID right now in the midst of all the crazy in the world. Do you know who's still on the throne? God Almighty is on the throne. Do you know what's changed in church? Absolutely everything. And none of us really like it. But do you know what I'm not going to do? Is let this perceived loss of identity let me think that the enemy is winning. Because I know with absolute certainty that God is sovereign. We trust in the Lord. We find refuge in Him. Second, pluralism. Pluralism is the idea that all roads lead to heaven or whatever. And so, again, right, there was a time even 20 years ago, 50 years ago, 100 years ago, where we could say one nation under God. And what we meant was one nation under God that's God of the Bible, right? God of heaven and earth that we've been reading about in Psalm chapter 9. Today, that's not the case. We live in a country that has all these different religions, and what does that mean for us? That there's people who are sitting there, and they're like, oh, Christianity is a thing of the past. You don't need that. You can pick your own God. It just it's pluralism. And the wicked are going to attack that foundation of our faith to say that there's only one God and His way is righteous, one way to heaven through Jesus Christ the Son. They'll attack that, and they'll try to do it to push us down. Third, assault on Christian values. You ever notice the way the church has backed down and given in to these things that are just an affront to the gospel, like the sanctity of marriage or life or just good old-fashioned decency that we ought to treat each other the way we like love your neighbor as yourself? When did that go away? And this is what the enemy says is, oh, you don't need those Christian values anymore. You don't need that stuff. And it's like they're trying to shoot us, like they're, remember the text. How can you say flee like a bird? Why? Why would we flee like a bird? Because we're being told that our Christian values don't matter, that our God doesn't matter, that the way we do things doesn't matter. And then the social gospel. And I want to bring this one out because what we see is churches twisting from gospel, Jesus Christ died for you, and you're not righteous without Him, to the gospel is just helping people. Let me be clear, it's good to help people, but helping people doesn't save them. They have to know the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so when we see churches abandon the gospel of Jesus Christ, that He died in our place, took our punishment, was buried, rose again on the third day, He's coming back to judge both living and dead. When we abandon that to say, oh, you did the good news if you just help somebody, Then we've run away into the mountains. We've hidden the shadows like the bird flying away from the hunter, just like the attacker wants us to do. So this is what we see. So trust the Lord, because the enemy's going to try to scare you off. And then we're going to suffer. And the way I put this is, God tests Christians. The Lord in his holy temple, the Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes see, his eyelids, listen, his eyelids test the children of man. The Lord tests the righteous, but his soul hates the wicked and the one who loves violence. And so there's two kinds of sufferings that are going on. One is the Christian is suffering, and the psalmist calls it a test. So you ever have a hard time in life, maybe like the psalmist here, you're trying to do right and the wicked, the enemy is against you and trying to scare you, trying to push you away, trying to not get you to do what you know you need to do. Just all this, just making you not feel like you're enough for God. And listen, first of all, you are enough because Jesus Christ died for you. Remember, blood, body makes you pure, justified before God. You don't have to worry about not being enough, but there is pain, right? There's pain that's exerted on us, on me and you, because of the wicked that are against us. The second suffering is the wicked. And the wicked one, God's soul hates the wicked and the one who loves violence. And we'll talk about that next. But first, Christian suffering, testing, suffering. First, it's not punishment. And it's important that we get this. God doesn't punish Christians. You know why? Because he punished Jesus for us, right? Jesus suffered and died once for all, for everybody who put their faith in him. God's not punishing you when you experience pain in your life. But there are two things that often happen. We can call them testing or kinds of suffering that Christians often experience. One is a Jonah test. One is a Job test. So a Jonah test, you remember Jonah? Jonah was the guy. He was, VeggieTales said, Jonah was a prophet. He never really got it. He's the guy that God said, I want to send you to Nineveh, and he went to Tarshish, right? He went the wrong way. He did 180 degrees away from where God wanted him to go. What happened to Jonah? God sent a storm. God sent a whale or a fish that swallowed him and vomited him up, and he had to go anyway. Why did Jonah suffer? Jonah suffered because of his disobedience to God, and that disobedience to God caused him to be in a situation that turned him around and put him back on the path that God wanted him to be on. Now, think about your life. You ever have something happen in your life that stopped you, just like put the brakes on because you're doing something that was against God? Maybe if that's the case, what God is doing to you is what he did to Jonah. And if you think about times when you knew God's will, you knew what God wanted, and you turned away and you went the other way, Jonah test. You suffer like Jonah suffered. Second thing, we suffer like Job suffered. And Job's suffering is so interesting because when you read through the book of Job, it's bookended by what really happened. And the devil goes before God, and there's this maybe antagonism, whatever, this story that plays out. Job suffers at the hand of the devil, and God uses it to prosper Job and to make Job a stronger person. But hear me. Job suffered a lot, and Job never knew why Job suffered. In your life, sometimes you will suffer a lot, and you will never know why you suffer, but at the end of it, you're going to be a stronger person because of it. And God is going to use that time of trial or tribulation or difficulty for his will, for your strength, for your betterment. And so just like Job, sometimes we suffer, and sometimes we get better because of the suffering that we go through. So this is what happens in our life, right? God is our refuge. And knowing God is our refuge, we still know there's enemies out there. And we still know that enemies cause us suffering. God uses the suffering to test us, to get us back on track, to make us better. God is not punishing us because he punished Jesus for us. And then judgment is coming, which is fourth. And it's so important that we get what the psalmist is saying in verses 6 and 7, that this is what he's saying to the enemy, the one that's the antagonist. Let him, this is God, rain coals on the wicked. Fire and sulfur and a scorching wind shall be the portion of their cup. Because the Lord is righteous. He loves righteous deeds. The upright shall behold his face. And what I want us to really just take in is the strength of the language that the Lord is going to rain coals, fire, sulfur, scorching winds. God is going to absolutely send hellfire and brimstone down on the person who's against him. Judgment is coming. And again, God's not punishing Christians when we suffer. He punished Jesus for us. But what we need to understand as Christians is that Christian, brother and sister, judgment is absolutely coming. God will not tolerate sin forever. You go to Revelation, you see how this plays out. God judges harshly. Sometimes we hear in our modern culture that, oh, well, you know, hell is just being away from God or being out of his presence. Or you know what we've done in our culture is we've worked really hard to make hell a little bit better. And we've diminished the value. You know what it does when we diminish hell? It diminishes our salvation. Because what we're being saved from is the devil's hell. What we're being saved from is punishment of wickedness, of the hellfire, the coals, the scorching wind, all of that. Go to Revelation 16. You'll see seven bowls are poured out and they cause boils. It's a picture of hell, of punishment. It's a picture of God's wrath poured out on the nations. Revelation 19, the sword that comes out of the mouth of the Lord, it decimates everybody so that his vesture is dipped in the blood of the people that stand against him. God's judgment is absolutely eternal and harsh and real and vividly described in all of the scriptures as something nobody wants to endure. God judges harshly. And Christian, we need to understand that, that God judges harshly, but God judged Jesus for us. You go to 1 John chapter 2 and chapter 4, what you see is that God sent Jesus to be the propitiation for our sins. And the propitiation is a fancy word that we don't use often, but what it means is that he's the sacrifice that took away the wrath of God. Specifically, he's the sacrifice that received the wrath of God. So the harsh punishment that God directs towards sinners, towards the unrighteous, Jesus Christ stood and said, I will take that punishment for these people. I will spread out my arms and die on a cross in the most horrid way for anybody who would believe in me so they could be saved. Listen, what it means is that we can stand behind Jesus Christ and he will take our punishment for us. But if we don't, we'll be harshly judged. So I guess what I want you to see here is that today you have a choice. You can stand before God and you can be harshly judged by the sin that's in your life. Or you can stand behind Jesus Christ and let him be harshly judged for the sin that's in your life. And when we do the Lord's Supper, what we're saying is it's the celebration of the judgment that Christ received for us. You go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Lord's Supper passage for today. And I know it may be awkward at home to listen and go through this, but you could grab some elements from your kitchen or just follow along. But the word reads like this in chapter 11, verse 23. I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, remember he's betrayed to go to the cross, to be beaten, nailed, killed. He took the punishment of God. He took bread, verse 24. When he'd given thanks, he broke it and he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And so here's the deal, right? Jesus was there. He took the bread and he broke the bread and he said, this is the body that is broken for you. When you eat this, you remember that the body of Jesus Christ was broken for you. And so we'll pray and then we'll receive the elements. God, thank you that Jesus Christ died for us. Thank you that he suffered for us. Thank you that he endured your wrath for us so that we wouldn't have to. And Lord, as we receive these elements, as we focus our lives on the sacrifice of Christ, we just pray that you would touch our hearts. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. And so Jesus took the bread and he told to them, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And they ate. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, this is the covenant of my blood. And so again, we will pray and then we will drink. And what I want you to remember is that the cup represents the blood of Christ that was shed for us. Father God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the blood that he shed that makes us just as if we'd never sinned before God, that makes us righteous so that we can count on God as our refuge and our stronghold. God, as we take this, I pray that our hearts would be focused on you. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. And so again, Jesus, as he had passed the bread in the same way, it reads, he also took the cup after supper, And he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And they drank. And as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let me pray for you. God, thank you for all of our friends and family, brothers and sisters in Christ that have joined us today. We thank you that Jesus took the punishment for us. We thank you, Father, for it in his name. Amen.
Here's my heart, Lord.